Good evening, everyone. Welcome to another CCT event. As we know, but I'll just again very shortly introduce CCT for the others who are not from a part of the school and have come for this program, for this event. So CCT is a program where we conduct the talks from by the architects or even from other background coming and sharing their experiences and projects. So it's basically a platform to connect for everyone in this discourse of architecture. So today we have Veeram Shah, who has his practice called Designing Dukaan. They are basically him along with his friends. I think they started in 2013. I mean, the inception happened then, and he's done his graduation from Pune, MMCA Pune, and post that he has not had any formal working experience, so as to say. But he right after his graduation, he started with his practice called Design Me Dukaan. And I think today what he's because he has this practice which is 6 years new or old to say. He's, I think, more than a project. He's also going to talk about the process of how did he or his team go around of making the projects or happening the projects like in reality or in practicality. So let's welcome him. And yeah.
Hi, can you hear me? Yeah. So I'm Veeram Shah. I'm the principal architect of this firm, Designer Dukaan. We started around 6 years back. The idea was to not define design by scale and take up everything. So basically, I'm an architect by profession. The idea was, it's a sort of an old school practice where if I'm doing architecture, I don't buy, I build. So furniture became a small subset of it. And then at this point, we are dealing with different scales of design. So we will not talk about my work as such. I think it's very important to understand the process that goes behind reaching an endpoint or how do you approach design. Also, my approach has been very non-linear, very non-conformist as such. So you talk about that, we'll see the story of the studio, how it has sort of come to this point right now. We'll talk about the current scenario of design. We'll go through the different approaches I've taken, and it's a very random sort of a presentation. I didn't want it to be very formal. So I think the this is something that I think has always made a lot of, always been very influential to me. What Corbusier said that when he went to America, that Negro music, that is jazz, has touched America because it is the melody of the soul joined with the rhythm of the machine. It is in two-part time, tears in the heart, movement of the legs, torso, arms, head, the music of the era of construction. Innovating, it floods the body and the heart, it floods the USA, it floods the world. Jazz is more advanced than architecture. If architecture were at the point reached by jazz, it would be an incredible spectacle. So, you know, jazz with Indian classical music, which have been very integral from the start of this, it's always improvisation, a certain build-up of the rhythm or an alap that goes to the tan, it's meditative. And I think that's an architect talking about other fields of art, I think, is essential, or even understanding other fields beyond architecture, I think, is essential in developing these principles to reach an endpoint. So, talk about the start. So, I am from a small town called Navsari. It's in South Gujarat. It's a small Parsi town. I grew up there before I shifted to Pune. And once I finished college, I was not very sure about what to do with life. And so we started doing things with our hands. My father used to restore antique furniture, and we had a set of carpenters who had worked with him for years and years. So this is Pujaram. He's still my sort of best friend. I mean, still is my work. So we started learning from him. We would go to the sawmill, understand what woods are locally available, how do you calculate wood, what sort of joineries happen. And this is my backyard. This is my house in Navsari, where we started doing things with hand, doing 2-3 products, figuring out how to go about doing the smallest things. So this was like a very informal setup where we used to work in seclusion. Initially, we would be working, doing chairs, we were doing this architectural project for the past 5 years that started there. This is my collection, my father's collection of antiques, which we started sort of analyzing or documenting. And we thought, why don't we do contemporary versions of the same? So, and then this was something that we did in our free time, where we'd be doing scooters. It was extremely random at the start. And then I realized that you need to have a formal office in a city. So this is the Ahmedabad office. This is my current setup. So we have a very informal office. It's more than an office. It's a sort of a community space where people come together and design. We have a sort of a no cabin office where everyone is valued only by how much they can produce. So there are different age groups of people coming together and just celebrating design as such. So we have this small garden, we have a small gazebo, we do informal meetings. So this is the first office, this is the workspace. So we did a lot of experiments. This was around 4 years back, where we put in all we could into doing the smaller details, at least for our own space. This is the extension that we did this year. So with the community growing, I realized that there's a need for even more. So we realized that we need a space to sort of relax. This is my desk now. We have a lot of cats in the office, so there's cats everywhere. We have a bathroom now. We have a place to sleep. In case you're working late, people can just relax or sleep. So this is an extension of my house, an extension of my lifestyle. This is the space. This is how it looks. We did different experiments with this project. We didn't want to add colors to this space. So it's a sort of a neutral palette. And most of the things were designed in-house, the light fixtures, the tables, the chairs, everything. This is our favorite part. This is the mezzanine on top, where we sort of relax or think. This is the pantry. We just still have to develop a little. So I'll give an overview about how we work. So I like working with hands, which has been the start of it. So we always look for materials or skills that are sort of very worthy, something that you can feel or touch or understand in terms of the details. There's a lot of weaving that we do. There is a lot of experiments in IPS that we did at the start. And then this is my workshop. So we have a lot of experiments with every project. So I don't produce furniture commercially, but it's a sort of design and execute thing, where furniture is designed to the context, to the client requirements. And I have a team of around 25 carpenters that work for me. This is another sort of a picture. So always, there's this thing, you know, this crafts as a word has been so misused, I think, because there are so many these small units, say, in all of Rajasthan, where the carpenters are sort of put and they're reproducing the same items again and again, and it is sold under the terms crafts, you know. But I think as an architect, it is not right to romanticize the fact that you're supporting the artisan, because if you push yourself to design something, which will push the carpenters to design something, because this is a sort of a generation to generation profession where they've been doing the same things. So if you push them to design something, you realize your vision and you sort of empower them to create something new. That's, I think, how it should be. I think we should leave the romanticism to the NGOs probably and just design. So this is the current scenario. So at least in Gujarat, the practice, say interior design practice, is doing the floors and the false ceiling. The furniture is either bought or someone like me does the furniture. The art comes from somewhere else. Also the internet. So now it's it's very easy to get information, and if you don't want to be sort of influenced, you are always there, your phones are there, there's Pinterest. So, and this is a very bad practice, and I've seen even senior architects sort of following this. I mean, eventually there's so much information that you don't really know how do you approach design, may it be any scale, you know. And yeah, design becomes a self-conscious art of assembling products, you know, the one sofa comes from China, one art piece is from somewhere else. And yeah, I think this line I find very interesting. The premature offspring of this design process is a unique mosaic of objects suspended in the space looking at each other, trying to find out a reason for the existence and the purpose of the exhibition. So, you know, this is what is the scenario, that Italian design or Malaysian design. I mean, how do you define what is Malaysian, what is Turkish design? And it's a very bad practice because the commercial and the clients, they come saying that we want something Italian, but how do you define what is Italian? You know? And the problem, the big problem I face with architects is the the point where they should be educating the clients about why should we build here and why can't we build here is a big issue. Because I think we, after this practice of 6 years, I know that we can produce enough which is comparable to what is being produced in the Chinese or the Italian markets. So there's a very interesting thing I came across. There is this book by Gautam Bhatia written in 2007 called The Whitewash. So this book is only sarcasm about everything prevalent in the sort of Indian conditions, politics, architecture, design, everything. So he, this is one sort of an ad which is a sarcasm that he has put. So this is what he says, you know, ask for our catalog today and we will laugh at you and tell you to bring your own catalog. And this is, I think, very relevant right now because it is so easy to copy you. An architect gives one image from the internet to the carpenter and tells him kaisa bana do of this size, but doesn't realize that that man is not, he's not educated enough to understand how the proportion should be. And as long as you change one proportion in someone's design, it's a crime. It's a very nice article that I came across. Next, you talk about influence. Like I said, I've not had formal training under an architect, but there are certain architects, there are a lot of things as influences that I could talk about. There are a few images that have stayed with me for some time through this thing. So I think first is, we talk about Carlos Carpa. This is, I've studied or seen his work again and again every year, you know. So this is, this project is very, I find it very interesting. This is a Brion tomb. A couple commissioned him to make a sort of a campus just for the tombstones. So this is, I find the first image very interesting because, you know, it's a bare concrete sort of a setup, and then there is, he's creating focus with that one brass pulpit. This is also part of the campus where I always talk about the intangibles and tangibles. It's a very simple way of looking at things, you know, where your work is a balance of the intangibles, things that you can feel, things you can't control, and tangibles what you can build. I think it's, this work is around 50 years old now. I think if the green is the intangibles, and it's such a perfect picture how the things that you can't control is actually creating that whole space, the whole image. So this is the same project. This is the tomb of the couple. So what I find very interesting is that, you know, he's done the this. So there are two contrasts in terms of the materials describing life and death. Also at the end of the journey, you sort of come, you go down to the ground as an act of humility to sort of get to the graves. And the best is that he has inclined these two tombs to each other, signifying that, you know, they are even in heaven or hell, they are sort of together. A very simple expression, but I think it's very powerful. And this is the Olivetti showroom. So he was born in Venice. He would always have influences of water in his work. Also, what I find very interesting about this project is the staircase is not just a staircase. It is so much more in terms of detail. Then this is something that I've been looking at for the past 3 years. And I think 6 months back, I realized the importance of it. So I've always been looking at Christ right there. And I realized after all this time looking at the same image that Christ is not embedded there. You know, it's actually here. You know? You can see the navel and you can see the two legs coming down and making the cross on top. So it's such a simple expression, which I think you see it again and again, and then you realize that it's the mastery of that man's mind that he could incorporate something in such a subtle nuance. Again, one more tombstone. So you see the variety in the scale of work that he has produced. So this is the sort of a tomb for the some. The font. So this is ZILIO. The cross, which is not actually a cross. There's a space to put the candles. So, like, I mean, how do you define the scale of design? Then there's Roger Anger. So his work has always been about patterns. So you see this sketcher and how it translates very seamlessly into a form in a plan. You see this pattern, how it's, you scale down the pattern. I think eventually I always tell my students to put a human figure next to a pattern and see what scales you can produce with the same pattern. Similar, you give a three dimension to a simple sketch and becomes a part of a facade. Again, same sort of observations in sketches put into practice into houses or small elements of a house, and how seamlessly art translates into functional parts. And this is one more thing that I think I find very interesting. He would always create a sort of tension in his work, you know, where the columns wouldn't touch the ceiling, where you see a large sort of a fireplace, a volume hanging from the ceiling, or dust on the ground, and also it sort of takes care of the space around it. And Boel Marx is something that we studied very much at the start. So he was a landscape artist that did a lot of work in landscapes. So, you know, when you look at this, this is the Miami Boulevard. So it's patterns, it's so many patterns. And when you see this and you see how it translates into a very different scale where it becomes a part of that whole boulevard, it's very interesting. And then again, you come down to say a sketch, which becomes a mural, which is actually the facade of the whole building. So again, then this was never realized. These are stained glass windows for a church, for a synagogue, I think. So when you see these patterns and you go back to these patterns, you see that the art was so seamless. There's a clear way of thinking, a certain principles around which they work. And then again, so this is him. So he worked with ceramics, he worked on painting. There are so many things. But so that's how you can never define design to a certain scale. And then again, jewelry. So coming from a boulevard to coming down to the scale of jewelry. So also, we go off the topic a little. We were forced to watch Pathir Panchali, the Apu trilogy, in our first years of college, and it made no sense to me. And I've been watching that film almost every year once. And every time I watch it, there is something else that I notice from the film. About him, I think the best parts are that, you know, he would work with the simplest context. The characters would be extremely simple. The whole trilogy is about the story of a boy and how he grows up. And he would work in the most minimal settings, you know. So this is, there are certain scenes from Pathir Panchali. And you see the characters, there's a certain simplicity, which I realized that you would work within that simplicity and create something which is very dramatic, which I also try to do with my work. Work with the simplest materials, but create something beyond what you see in the market. So again, emotions, there's a lot that you can sort of talk about the scenes, but you won't get into the details of it. This is the second movie, Aparajita. And this is the last scene from the movie, which is, I think, the best scene, where he sort of goes through that whole journey of growing up and then he finds his child again. Also, beyond that, he has done a lot of posters. So this is for Charulata. So the significance of that bindu to the calligraphy, which was done myself. Then there are, this is Feluda. So posters done for books for the series. Then this is Man-Eaters of Kumon, Jim Corbett book that he did the cover for. So the versatile sort of, you know, practice, I mean, you can't call it a practice, but I mean, and then set design for Chatran Ke Khiladi. So illustrations, I mean, I don't think you can restrict yourself to doing one thing. I mean, it has to be based on principles. And then corpus, I think this is someone, I mean, that we have all sort of seen. So adding art to those is something that I found very interesting, which he did. And the scale, you know, so you'd have bare concrete walls, and the whole concept of Chandigarh is embedded in the High Court, in the door. And also this is Rashab, which we all have seen. So even being an atheist, I don't think if this world didn't exist, this structure would be, you're actually facing God the other side, but the effect is created through architecture. And again, analyzing his forms from his paintings, his plans, his volumes, it's, you see a similarity in thought, a process that he has sort of taken forward through his life. This is the lab tour. So basically, these partitions were designed on the intervals of a symphony that an architect in his office was working on. So again, coming back to what we spoke about jazz, as you know, art being a seamless entity and how it becomes a part of all your designs. So this, now we talk about how I have approached. This is something that we started doing very early. So that time we were doing a lot of, we were following a lot of bowl marks. So we, this was a watercolor that one of my friends had done initially, which we converted into a mural in wood and brass. We casted the brass, we did, and then eventually this was done as a study experiment for a pattern in landscape in a large scale, around I think 3 meters for the project, that for an architectural project. So again, you see different scales and how different ideas are sort of carried out in different mediums. Then we started, I have always been analyzing Corbusier's paintings, the curves, because there's a certain imperfection in his curves, which is very profound to think of it. So this is a chair we did very early, which was inspired from those forms. You take tracings and just keep sketching the curves to get to the right curve. This was a sofa that we designed around that. So this was just one elevation that we sketched at the side. And so let us give it a form. Let us give it a three-dimensional sort of a thing. And handle. So this is the handle at, I think, the Chandigarh door. And so sort of implying that into smaller. This was a bed we did for a, so the children's bed that we did. So similar principles put into different scales. This is a center table that we did for a project. So small things, you know, the patterns, the breaking, the functionality. So this becomes a handle for, this is a drawer. So also this is the mastery project. So the columns. So this is a very large volume supported on these columns. So a sort of relevance of that into a different scale where you have a large volume which is supported on similar looking columns. And then I have always liked interpreting simple forms. So I think this is Surya Namaskar by Raza. So you'd always have these representations of abstract ideas in simple forms in the circle, and how the circle becomes so important. Then this is something very relevant to the younger generation. But you see the Bindi, and this is Satyajit's film again, Devi. So I found the relevance very interesting of how that continuation idea is still so interesting. This is the Oculus in the Pantheon. So, you know, these very small, simple forms, but they, in very different contexts, they become such integral parts of these ideas. So this is also something that we did. So the circle becomes a mural on the wall, becomes a light. Then this is a very simple table we did, very pure forms, two circles. So this is a project which is very interesting. So we, the circle again, you have a light fixture, you have a mural, you have a table. So like a symphony of triumph circles. This was, I think, 2 years back. And then again, this was a proposal for a canteen we had done around, I think, 5 years back. So if you see, this is also sort of following an incomplete circle and then a circle embedded within it. So we're not going into the details of it, but just it, reinterpreting these forms in terms of different scales of projects. Patterns. So I always, patterns is something which is very subjective, because there is, I mean, you can't define a good or a bad pattern. I started doing patterns and golden ratios. I always tell my students to sketch, keep sketching patterns. And then we talk about it, we analyze what proportion is correct or what, why is it not correct. So this is a large sort of wardrobe we did for a project. So this just started with random sketches of lines on the wall. Again, so you have these patterns that were done in SS. These were, every piece was sort of cut by hand and put on the, this is a reception table that we did. So this is for the same project. This is a 60 feet ceiling that we did in parts, which was made in the workshop and put on site. So this is all sort of following that same language. So we always patterns and then sort of putting down the pattern in different materials, different textures, different colors. And then this was an experiment we did with a fabric artist. So again, similar pattern. So this was sandwich glass pieces we did for an office, which was also sort of an off-site done project. So started with lines, and then we did the weaving on the fabric, and we embedded that into the glass. One more cupboard that we sort of based on patterns. It's a new project. So in this, you've added nuances in terms of the circles, the handles, breaking down the volume of the cupboard in terms of adding fabric to it. So materiality is something I've been working on for the last year. I realized that at this point, I would like to sort of push the properties of materials to understand, to create more art into all the work we do. So we have been working with a few artists from MSU Arts. So they have been working with ceramics, with brass in a smaller scale. What I'm trying to do now is to understand how these materials react to different things and then take it into furniture in a larger scale. So this is something that we've been trying. So this is a copper acid sort of a base that we mixed with brass. This is one more experiment that we are doing. This was one project, it's a very small project we did for a doctor in Surat. So he mentioned Wabi Sabi, young guy, and I was not very sure of what it actually was. I read up. It's a Japanese art of imperfection and simplicity, which I realized is anyway is very inherent in the kind of stuff I do. So we started with understanding what materials to use and how do we deconstruct the properties of these materials to create pieces which are sort of beyond what I have been doing or beyond the normal norm of what furniture could be. So we got a lot of organic fabrics. We saw how they sort of reacted with light because we had to make a screen at the back of the whole panel. So this was, so we created fabric, saw how they sort of react to light. Then there was a lot of, so with stone, we decided that let's keep a certain simplicity in what we build and let's also deconstruct the idea of what a table would be. So it would be done in stone and wood. Now, initially, we thought we'd put a boulder. We had to sort of transport this 300 kilometers away to Surat. So we deconstructed the whole base into, I think, 36 slabs, which were imperfectly drawn. We did one-to-one sort of drawings for the guy. Now, the chiseling happened, but it was too refined. So we had to actually get the mason to make the edges sort of rough. It was an interesting experiment because he was like, why are you making me do something against what I do? So they're used to doing that refined sort of edges. So and eventually, because that anticipation of that human error was something that we thought of, that it will come, and we left it to him. Then weaving. So we also, there's a Japanese art of burning wood, which is called Shoshokiban. So they usually do it with oak and all local varieties of wood that you get in Japan. We tried doing that with teak. So tried to distress the wood. We actually created a machine in the workshop which would distress the wood. We burnt it, so all the top layers would go off, and so it wouldn't need polish. So this was an extremely raw sort of an experiment. Even brass. So we, like I said, that time we did not let it react with acid, but we burnt the brass to create these sort of patterns. So this is how the final output came out, where this is the different fabrics that we experimented on, which became like a screen at the back. This is the table, and also this is the wood. So you can see how the grains are so pronounced. And this is, again, I'll show the whole picture. And this is, again, experiments with cane. So this is how the whole space looks. So you have a screen at the back. You have and you had very specific requirements of where you would place what. Files, LP players, coffee machines, which was, so basically, always tell that I think your everything you design has to be a balance between what the functional needs of the clients are and what your artistic expression should be. So basically, with this, these materials are going to age with time. So right now, when I visited the office, I think after a year, the brass, we gave the brass a starting point to age. So now the brass has become darker, and the lines that we have tried to create over the parts that were burnt have become more pronounced. So it's very interesting to see how. So this photo shoot was done when it was done. So I always tell, you know, even the photo shoots, you know, all these architects, they are in such a hurry to get the photo shoot done just as the project is done because they think the client will mess up the house or, you know, it will get shabby. But eventually, you're going to live in that house. I think if you're going to design museums and then sort of publish it as glossy photos, there is no point in it. So I think I want to sort of photograph this project at least for the next 5 years to see how it ages. And that is when the that is when I realized if the experiment was a success or not a success. So this is that space. So reinterpreting memories. So I grew up in a small town with a very small, simple upbringing, no background of art as such. And it was a Parsi town outside. So we'd always have these babas sitting on those chairs in the verandas. This is the first chair we did around 6-7 years back, where I said, why don't we do a contemporary version of the planter chair? Then swings is something that I've been making for a while. So good swings have always been a essential part of every Gujarati household, and I've seen the same swing sort of repeated over time. So this is a swing that we have done. It's a reversible swing, it goes both ways, and it's a sort of floor mounted swing done in brass plate. So all the hardware was custom done in the workshop. So this is how the back sort of goes both. This is a ceiling mounted version of the same. So like I mentioned before, I've seen that drama that Rajanga creates with his work is very important. So there are small expressions. This is a canteen that we did. So just a small wall and, you know, two forms, and they don't touch each other. Separating elements of furniture in a different scale, where just simple experiments which follow the same principles. And this is very interesting. This is the architecture project that I've been doing. So we did not actually need this column. Because the slab was supported on this wall. But for the sake of symmetry, I said, let the column be. And I said, if it's not needed, then let it not touch the ground to create that sort of tension. So this marks the entrance of the passage. So this had to be there to sort of, if this wasn't there, you would not sort of be able to diminish where the passage starts and the other space ends. And then again create separating slabs. So this was done way later in the project, where we did these punches in the ceiling. So this passage is going to be an art gallery once the project is done, which leads to two rooms. Even when we've been in Navsa, we always had discussions about, say, literature or art or music as such. So there is this Kabir bhajan that has been sung by Pandit Kumar Gandhar. It's called Nirbhay Nirgun. So in that, the sort of meaning in short is, Kabir talks to God and he says that I will sing about your attributes. He's talking to God. He tells him that I will sing about your attributes fearlessly. But the paradox is that as God, you are formless. So you don't have attributes. So what do I sing of that? I found that paradox very interesting, and sort of it translated into this project that we're working on for the last 5 years now. So basically, when I met the client, this is around 5 years back, so we're at a very immature age where we're presenting designs. So he mentioned that he didn't want an elevation, which was very interesting. And that sort of translated very seamlessly into the house not having a form. So this is the current plan of how where it has come to. So you enter from here, there's a public part to the house, where he entertains his guests, etc. So every part of the house opens out into two parts. So there's a smaller court, a larger court. You come down to the private areas, it opens out a larger court, a smaller court. This is a small informal area which leads to his private rooms. These are the guest rooms, these are rooms for his sons, and which leads to even the more private part. So when you sort of, the small video that I think, one second, I don't know how to play this. So this is the current stage of that project. So you have had all these sort of sculptures coming up. They are going to be bare walls, and these will be all the courts in the center, the smaller court. This is going to be an artist gallery which will overlook a dense forest that we are developing. This is the service block in the corner. And so this is the entry. So it's a very discreet entry, like a parasol roof coming together. So when you enter the house, you don't realize what sort of a scale you're getting into. But once you start moving around the house, it unfolds into parts. It's like a story. So this is the smaller courts. And then this is the most private part of the house, where you have the pool and his son's rooms coming up. So all these sort of sculptures were added later because they wanted more things within the peripheral walls, but we couldn't break the peripheral walls. And these are all guest rooms. So every room opens on two sides. So this is how it's going to be when it's done. And even through college, I've always sort of, you know, when you talk, there's so many architects, and especially at the start of the practice, where a project was designed by an architect and the elevations were done by some other architect. So I don't really understand how, I mean, the essence of an elevation is nothing because you're going to actually live in the house. And it was a very good opportunity at that time to create something which would make that statement true. So this is how the landscape will come over the house, and you see only these, so you don't have the other sculpture coming up. So there's a conversation between these two sculptures that will happen now. And there's a landscape, there's almost half an acre of landscape that we're doing. This was a model that we did long back for the house, where you worked on the smallest details, the spouts, the courts. And so this is how meticulous we wanted to be from the start about everything we do. Maybe a model or the architecture or furniture or small details or knob or handle. And that is what the whole practice is, that you don't define design by scale. And currently we are doing the interiors for this project. We are designing it. So every piece of furniture is going to be designed according to the client's lifestyle. Nothing is going to be bought. Yeah, so even this sculpture that was there at the start, water feature. So this is the fun part of this. So I always tell my students, they just observe, you know. So this is, I don't know if you see this, is a movie called Arrival. So we have these movie screenings in office, random movies. You watch commercial, crappy movies also. So watching this, and I was like, you know, there's something very correct about the form. And next day, you have to design a center table. So I just sketch the same form. So this is going to be a 6 feet center table. So this is going to be done in wooden strips, which we're going to burn later. So currently, in the last 3 months, we have been focusing on how to add more art to all the pieces that we design. That is a center table, then let's not keep it too functional. Let's experiment beyond it. I've been a big sci-fi fan. So this is a US interface on the Star Trek. So this is something that I've seen with my father since my childhood. And so this is how somehow, you know, it sort of seamlessly relates to Scarpa coming in, the patterns coming in, that whole cantilever of that Star Trek ship. So this is a very interesting thing that this is how we sold it to the client. So I go to the site, and so this client, there are these very simple minded people. The brief was that we drink in every corner, so nothing should get spoiled. So that's sort of simple. Khatris, Surat Khatris, I don't know if you know. So he comes and says, yeah, my son's friend has gotten a bed which looks like a Lamborghini, and he's after my life to get the same bed. So obviously I told him that, you know, I'm going to design something like that. Then it struck me that, I mean, why not design like a spaceship that's not done for anyone? And so I told him, don't worry, we'll design something which is better than a Lamborghini. And through the presentation, we didn't send drawings, we sent this and we sold it. He was like, yes. So his son is the most excited about this bed. So we're going to have like his toys in the front. This opens up, there's a light here, there's a place to put the PlayStation consoles, there's going to be lights here, there's going to be lights under. So I don't know, I think selling is a very important part of this practice also. This is Watchmen, Captain Manhattan. It's one of these, I think, one of my favorite movies. So I found the Bindi again in a very different way, but very interesting. And then we just put, I said, let's make a knob like that. Then again, this is from Star Wars. This is a scooter. This is in the old movies. And so this is the same project where I said, let's put Star Trek in the tables, so let's put Star Wars in the ceiling light. So sort of the same cantilever coming out. So this, after all this while, you know, this has also been very vague. It has been irrational. It has, there's no linear thought, like I said. But now at this point, we have been trying to assimilate all these ideas into creating more refined forms in terms of the lines, the details, because I think only with patience you can understand what scale or what form is correct. So this is, so after the sketching, these are the sort of presentations that we do to the client, so they understand. We talk about the fact that we only deal with the proportions, the curves of those units. So, you know, these are center tables. as patterns. These were derived from Corbusier's paintings. This is a center table, which will be a half circle with a sort of a cylinder inserted inside. This is going to be a chair, which is separated in forms. The seat is one. The framework is separate. And these are the kind of drawings that we produce. This is a table. It's in three parts. So there are three volumes. You have a layer at the bottom, which is a plane. This volume in the center becomes a functional part, and there's a top, stone top. So you see that when you add tables to it. Then this is a chair that we are doing. This is going to be done in bent wood again. So this is like a refined version of all these ideas that has come to now, how we are approaching design. So again, we are doing a series of tables. So I said, if you are doing one, so when we sit and sort of design these patterns, I make sure that whoever's designing it has at least 25 to 30 options of just patterns. And then we sort of come down to deciding how much code to keep, how what not to keep. And so I said, let's design a series of tables of different scales and different. So this has become a very interesting exercise. And this went on for almost a month to get the right shapes. So I thought we can end the presentation in a sort of a little sort of a fun way. So I was going to put a very heavy Kishori Amonkar piece to sort of assimilate the nuances of a rag that she had sung. When I said you'll probably be sleeping by the time the lecture's over. So there is this song by Pink Floyd called Pigs on the Wing. So I've been playing the song for, I think, all my life, you know, forever. Now, just a month back, I realized that so basically, the song is a progression of only three chords. There's a G, there's a C, there's a D, and there's a F, which comes later. So I realized that within the whole song is just assimilation of variants of the same chords. And if those chords didn't exist for a second, that song wouldn't be the way it is. Will the sound play? Yeah. So this is a chord progression which will have nothing to press it to. Studio also, since you've started, you know, that you don't listen, you observe, you know, with any kind of music, you know, you listen to classical, you listen to this, but there are these certain nuances you will not even realize. With a circle of life, it'll automatically seamlessly come in your work, you know. Where do you place that knob, or where do you cut the lines, or what proportion should sort of come within your work? And so this is, I'll end again with Corbusier. This is something that I read long back, and it's sort of been a struggle, but now we are sort of set. So this is something that he said, that we have been the ones to receive kicks and blows on the nose, back, the head, wherever you like. Such things occur. Much work has been done, even so, and I am certain that the next two generations in 50 years will have achieved something remarkable. If poetry is not in the facts, it will be in the hearts of men or in their desire. But they will always argue with one another. There are those who make money out of these ideas, then they will always make money. There are those who put vanity in these ideas, and they will always be vain. And those who have a certain social spirit and who will try to talk together, which is difficult, for it takes time. And such problems require long development. They cannot be flipped like a crepe. the entire task facing modern society is addressed to those who have the desire to give something and for something. They will be called dupes by some of their friends and the friends of the society by others. We do not work to be praised, you work out of a duty to a conscience which is within. I find it very interesting because he's not actually saying what is wrong or right, but he's probably, I think the last line is what works. You know, we work out of a duty to a conscience which is within. And I think that's the end of the presentation. Yeah, thank you. Thank you for being here.
Thanks, Veeram. That was a very power-packed presentation. So, I'll open it to the audience if you have any comments, questions, observations.
Hi, thank you for the presentation. I just wanted to ask you, in one of your projects which had the free form, the one which had the 360 drone shot, in many of them, the walls which were on the flanks and then there would be a curve, you had kept a gap between it.
No, the construction is still on.
No, in the drawing there was a gap in that.
So basically, the if you follow the lines, let me get back to it. So there's a continuous line that follows. So basically the whole project, I didn't want to talk about the details of the project, but since you're at it, we'll just go about it. So if you see, so the project is in only two materials. There's a finished plaster and there's an exposed concrete. So if you see these lines, so these lines sort of continue to create the peripheral walls and then it separates here, there's a part to get out. So you have this part, which is separate. And then this wall, so this sort of comes and completes them to one form and this is a separate part. Is this what you're asking?
Yes. Yeah. So that's the path that you're taking. So it's a very narrow space that releases.
Yeah, it was. So the project, the whole project was done in only four lines. So it starts, so this is one line which continues and ends at this point. There is one line that continues and ends at this point. And then there's a curve and then just the two straight lines. So that was the design development. So, I mean, I don't want to get into the details of the project, but you asked, so I'm putting it right.
I have a question related to the furniture. So, I've seen different processes of how the whole furniture is getting designed and all. So, I have one question since a long time. That how do you communicate with the carpenters or the artisans that you work with? And then how does that communication happen? How is the dealing with them?
It takes a lot of supervision. So, I have had... I've been working with different, I've had two carpenters mainly. One is the carpenter who works in Navsari for me. So him I've known since childhood. So the different way I work with him. And basically this is a lot of supervision, you know. So also drawings. I think drawings are something that I didn't discuss. But this question comes up, you know, because a lot of architects outsource their work from me. And the question always is that, the way it's put forward is that, how do you find such good craftsmen? But that is not the case. As an architect, I think if you do your drawings well enough, he can't make a mistake, you know. So initially we used to do very detailed CAD drawings, even the sections of where the veneer would end, where the wood would come. And now the carpenters are trained to understand these. So we do these very detailed SketchUp models. So we get a very clear idea of how the forms are going to be. The client gets a very clear idea of the forms of how they're going to be. And we also have my carpenter's office also has a sort of a computer we put SketchUp. So in case he doesn't find something, just rotates the model and figures it out. And along with that, we make sure that we give him CAD drawings where necessary, the model. So that's what I mean. If you produce good quality drawings, then even for this project, so it's a very remote site. And the contractor, if I had gotten the contractor from the city, the cost of the project would have been at least three times. So we sort of anticipated that the concreting that happens in the peripheral walls is going to have defects. But that human error is what is actually will create that contrast between those two things, you know. So I think drawings and details are the only things to communicate to the carpenter, you know, and supervision.
Actually, I am struggling to reconcile an irony that I perceived in your practice. You began by kind of gently critiquing this whole thing of, people consuming so many images and Pinterest and also you kind of concluded by stating Gautam Bhatia, who says, you know, that people have made their own catalog.
Yeah.
But I think you yourself seem to have your own catalog, and where you constantly keep on trying to mix match, draw from different architects very directly, very very direct quotations. How do you kind of
I think it's a set of influences, you know, everyone. See, there's no simple path to developing these principles that you're going to put in your practice. For me, it has never been an architect that I worked with. You know, it's almost been like Eklav, you know, where I've seen things, understood the importance of an image or a detail of how parts are separated. And then I've tried to put that into practice in different scales.
So you mean to say that it's legitimate for a designer to do that, but not for a layman?
No. The point is copying something from the internet the way you see the picture, you know. But deriving something out of someone's art and assimilating or this sort of deconstructing that and putting it in your work is a very different thing.
But there are different kinds of assimilations then, which can lead to different kinds of solutions.
Yeah, but that's what it is in the end, you know, that you.
So why is one sacred and the other profane?
Because it is a direct copy of someone's work. That is what
I think. There was a lot of direct referencing in your works too. Sapa.
Yeah, but that's what, I'm talking about architects taking images of the internet and giving that directly to the, so this is about understanding scale and proportion also. When you sort of deconstruct someone's work in a larger scale, and when you put it into a smaller scale in terms of a knob or a handle, that is actually figuring out the importance of how that scale is correct, right? You're not saying that this is a 3 feet table done by someone and you're creating a 6 feet version of it. And then you leave it to the layman to sort of decide on what proportions to put in the same table.
Isn't scale subjective?
It is, but I mean everything is subjective.
There is no correctness in scale.
There is no correctness. That's what I'm saying. There is no correctness. But this is my practice. This is how I've done it, and I put it out as it is. You know, that's why I don't have really high-minded ideas about how life should be lived. This is how it has been. You know.
As a discussion of what you're having right now, I feel what he's trying to say is that it's the idea or the act of directly copying the aesthetic of something that you see online, rather than understanding of what principles went behind doing it the way it was done. And it's the understanding of, say, one principle, one person's, Corbusier's, somebody else's, which will lead you eventually to, you know, define what you think is the right way. You can't, there's referencing of pop. So a tree, yeah, exactly. So there's an understanding of copying the form, and there's an understanding of how the form came about. And to understand that, you have to study the form, won't you?
Yeah, there's
like
always been
a
sort of
a certain way, right?
Sort of a guru shishya thing.
And then you decide whether you want to follow a religion or you don't. First, you're trained to follow a certain religion. Then you may question. So, you know, I think it's that kind of an
understanding. Yeah, and even with, it's always been a sort of a guru shishya thing. And if you see Doshi's work, then you see references of Corbusier that comes in, you know. So that modernism, you know, talk of it, it's a sort of linear path. Now, it started somewhere. There were people who sort of believed in the movement, believed or worked with architects who worked with the same. So you see Doshi's work, you would always see some references, or he would always talk about Corbusier as a sort of a teacher to him, you know. So the parasol roofs, there's so many things. So that is exactly what I'm talking about, you know. That understanding how someone approaches design by principle and seeing how you can approach that same thing in different scales, you know. So it's hard, you know. Doshi does, like, you know, Doshi does a painting, you'd still see the same references, the sort of modernist references that has brought him to that point of reaching that level, you know. For anyone, I think.
As a very lame example, maybe, if I was to tell you to create a form and don't reference any form in the world, what would you do? You'd either start with a line or a dot or a circle. You know, I mean, it's that.
No, it's a very different thing. I think we've spoken enough about it. I mean, there's no solution to it.
I mean, in some ways, it's about the idea of a quotation. You know, you're quoting certain, and the whole kind of postmodern architecture really kind of came from this idea that quotations are okay. You know, it's okay to quote, right? And the whole idea of modern architecture was about originality. You know, you invent certain things. There's certain kind of originality of things. So I think your work is working in this kind of idea of the quotations that one is actually working with and prefacing and, you know, working around with it. Correct. Which is what one has to understand. That, you know, I mean, in some ways, when you look at the first, I mean, the preface that you did, you know, of the fact that people are in some ways lifting or, you know, kind of making things into catalogs, there's a certain kind of way in which one is operating in a certain kind of larger realm of things.
Mm.
So I think there is, you know, what Anuj was talking about, there's something to think about there rather than kind of, you know, dismissing. Yeah, there's something else going on over there. So I think one has to think about that probably completely separately from your practice.
Mm.
That is not to take away from your own practice, because there is a kind of act of, you're talking about the idea of scale, right? You're saying sans scale,
yeah.
One actually works at a kind of various scales of operation. There's a compression, there's an expansion. And in that, it's kind of taking this act of quotation to another level. So I think there is kind of merit in understanding that particular methodology of working.
Honestly, you know, even I haven't analyzed myself so
much. But I think it's interesting. I mean,
today
I know
something that
it's important. No, I actually, because this is something that architects often don't do, you know, to kind of think of self-consciously. You use the word self-conscious a lot in your presentation, but what is it that one is actually doing? You know, what is the practice about? Because only that will allow the practice to grow. Because otherwise it will kind of remain in this level of, exactly in the debate that you started off, in this kind of visuality of something and sort of bringing it from there. But what is the project actually doing, or what is the practice doing? And then what would then the next step be? That would be interesting to think.
Like I said, you know, there is no linear thought or a solution or sort of an analysis to what I do, because, you know, I don't know what I'm doing, you know. Probably in the next 3 years, I might not just do this, you know. But the thing is that you create, you know. As an architect, I've never wanted to speak. I never want to talk about my projects. But there's a certain way, a certain story behind where we have reached, you know, where we are creating things, we are experimenting with materials, which is what I want to speak about, just the process. There's nothing above or below that.
But I think there is a kind of romanticism in that as well.
Absolutely.
You cannot think about, like, the artists that you work with at MSU.
Yeah.
I mean, you kind of talk to them. They're also constantly working with some question. You know, it's a question that one is actually following, you know, critique. And it's a kind of practice. It's a practice. It's not a project that one is doing, or it's not an object that one is making. It's a practice. And somewhere you have that practice, it might help you to slightly self-consciously think about that practice to kind of also chart out your own journey, you know, which is I think very interesting. But I think that might be really useful for one to, you know, think through.
Let's see, I hope so.
You spoke about how your design is contextual in terms of furniture, I'm saying. So, for example, if there is a family who wants their furniture sort of not made out of wood, made out of wood, but when you visit their place, there is wooden furniture which is not maintained.
Mm.
So, how do you tackle such situations when they ask you to design something, but when you they have a thing at their home, but it's not well maintained? So, how do you, like?
I didn't actually get your question. Since that something is there, so no, rephrase.
They want something which they already have, but a better version of it. They're not good at maintaining.
That's not, so basically, how I work is, so when I collaborate with architects, they've seen my work, so they come to me for a reason. So they have a certain decor that they've sort of thought of. And then when I come in, we work on the functions that need to be incorporated in the pieces of furniture. Because a lot of times I have realized that with architects, architecture is one and furniture is something that they add on later. So basically, say this one project we did where the client said that his father has a habit of sort of reading the paper on the Diwan every day. So we added a lamp and a tree to the Diwan, so which would be his space to sit, you know. So very sort of user contextual. The visuals of the project are something that I decide. So I stress on the fact to the client that you tell me the functions you need. So say you have a cupboard, you know, so you tell me where you want to put the winter clothes, where the shoes are going to be. But you can't dictate how the design should be. So that's sort of a balance between the function and my vision of how it should be.
Along with the use of the word self-conscious that Rupali pointed out, you also use one more word a lot in your presentation, which is random. So what do you consider random? Because design is all about removing the randomness. So
I don't really have to answer that. I think a better word, or the better way to put it, is non-linear. You know, I don't really have any like what I spoke about crafts, you know. Like, I don't really have a material palette or something that I will use or won't use, you know. So every day, say I come across a new material, I have not made these strict principles about how things should be dealt with. So say, like, you know, the table, the SS table. So I've never worked with SS before. But the office was a corporate office. So the client, I suggested we do brass because I do brass all the time. It ages well. He said, no, we need to do SS. So that was the first time that we worked with SS. Now, I did not know how SS would go with wood. But he sort of balanced out how that piece would be made and go with the wood and the Italian on top. So I don't know. It's something I might negate something today, but tomorrow it might be something else. You know.
Hi. So I've seen in a lot of your projects, like, you have a lot of influences from art. So whatever projects or whatever design, or whether it's furniture or interiors or architecture, like, the scales actually vary, but the scales are actually influenced by the art. So my question is, like, now for the upcoming artist or the architect or anyone who is basically coming up in this industry, do you suggest them to actually know and study about the art and the artist, or do you just suggest them to just jump into the whole industry of architecture and just build buildings and interiors or whatever it is?
No, like I said, you know, it's a complete circle, you know. You can't, I don't think anything can happen in isolation, you know. So I think observing would be a good word to sort of put it, that you observe everything, you know. You observe, you know, the most mundane things that we saw, you know. And you understand, I think the process is being, because, you know, right now from the few exhibitions that I've been to, what I've seen is that you see, you think that you've seen the furniture somewhere, you know. So I think to sort of create that sort of path to creating your own work, or what would be unique about it, and which is also something, now, you know, the market is opening out into a lot of people who are getting into furniture product design. You see it a lot. And I think the market also knows of what is happening beyond that. People are coming, people are not actually going to China to buy Italian furniture. They're coming here and buying stuff locally made. So I think eventually you have to figure out how would you define your products to be something which is not there in the market, you know. And to sort of do that, you would have to undergo a process of understanding how to reach the end point. Or what sort of work do you want to create? And like he said, you know, there's, everything is subjective. There's nothing wrong or right, you know. There is the world, the market might like something which is absolutely shabby, or you know, something that you might not like. But I think probably stick to understand the sort of path of reaching that end point and stick to it, you know. And then I think to put those ideas into practice in any scale would be easier.
Okay, so rather than the like the idea of the random, I think it's more about being serendipitous, right? Like the idea of serendipity and the idea of chance.
You know, I think that's something that plays into your work, and it's a lot of the surrealists. I mean, you reference art a lot, no? So a lot of the surrealists actually work with this idea of the chance encounter. I mean, also because you're quoting several kind of interesting pieces there, I just wanted to say there's this quote by Lautremont, who talks about the chance, and he calls it as beautiful as the chance encounter of a sewing machine and an umbrella on a operating table. You know, so this whole idea that in some ways these are what you call random, with the beauty of the serendipitous coming together, and what does that then give you? What are those chance encounters that they are offering you?
Yeah.
So in some ways, you know, what your work is about that. Might be interesting to kind of, you know, think through that process.
Hello, I would like to ask you a little different question. Looking at your entire presentation, I observed that you like to play a lot with forms and the scale of that forms and material, thus creating a sense of art in your designs. But I want to understand whether that artistic element in your design has just a visual impact, or does it have an impact on the psychology of the spatial planner and especially the user?
But you know, when you consider furniture,
yes.
So with most of the things that I have done, you know, there's a certain context that has been, the projects have collaborated with other, there's a context that has been put forward. So the spatial quality or how the visual should be is decided within a close conversation between me, the project architect, and the client. For my own projects, we always have a conversation with the clients, you know. So we are doing this project, we are doing a mandir in a sort of a ellipsoid, and it's a very sort of a conservative Marwadi family. So for them, the concept of, say, a temple being just an ellipsoid was very vague. But then that is exactly where you try to explain your ideas. That is the selling part, you know, where you have to use your words or your ideas to convince them that, you know, this is how it should be. And beyond that, I think, like I said before, so furniture has to be a balance between the functions and the visuals. So visually, I have followed a certain idea of how I want to carry out my work. So that is what I follow. Like for the current project, we've been working on certain forms. The client is someone who understands those deconstructed forms, you know. So we went ahead with that. We had discussion saying that let's go with small. So there's always a conversation with the client that sort of comes out into these things, you know. And I mean, sometimes the client doesn't even understand, so it's easier to sell art that way.
Okay, I think should wrap it up. Thank you, Veeram. I think apart from the kind of, I really enjoy your work, honestly. And I do feel taking forward Rupali's observation that there is so much meat in articulating the vagaries of intuition that your practice has. It's a very intuitive practice, and you bring together forms which completely tell a new poetry, you know, and that poetry, that poetics of your form making exercise is something that we really look forward to be articulated further. So thank you so much for coming and sharing your work with us, and thank you all for coming from so many places. Our next CCT event is lined up 2 weeks down the line. And we'll update our website soon with the details. So please come back again. Thanks.